I feel like I've been made. I want to sing that song, Looks Like I Made It. Academy Award weekend, I guess, is my Academy Award. It's a great honor to be here. I got Chewbacca up front here. This is fabulous. Whoa, that is a very cute dog. As the founder of Dog Bless You, this little guy just said, hey, you have to bring me up here. And I've also learned, now that I brought up Daphne, I don't have to worry how the show goes, because everyone says the guy had a cute dog. I don't know if anyone, when they came in here, saw some waves in the backdrop. Did anyone see that?
Yes.
Okay. That's a new initiative. It's called Pearls of the Planet. The mission of Pearls of the Planet is simply to allow people to look at nature up close and personal with, you could almost say, the evil objective of falling in love with the world again. I think of Pearls of the Planet as the purest thing on the web. It's uncut, unedited, and truly special. And what you were looking at is, it happens to be today that in Waimea Bay on the North Shore, the waves are 35 to 50 feet. And there's a very famous surf contest called the Eddie, named after a gentleman, Eddie Aikau, who would be to Hawaii what Bob Marley would be to Africa. He is a symbol of selflessness and a hero. We happen to make a film on him called Guardians of the Sea. And so what you were looking at wasn't something that is recorded, but it's now as you're sitting here. And if people during this talk get bored, wander, just go to explore.org. And right now, because of time zone, you might have some problems, but you can look at the pandas in China. Every panda that you see at any zoo comes from this one center, and it's live. You can look at hummingbirds right now as they've just given birth. You can look in Africa at a watering hole as animals gather, because it would be daylight. This summer, really some of the true pearls, you can watch the brown bears. I don't know if people know that the brown bears are simply the grizzly bear's bigger brother as they hunt the salmon in Alaska. Or in the winter, you can watch the polar bears as they wait for the ice to freeze. So it's a really educational tool. And as I said, this is live. I was honored. Maybe I'll put Daphne down if she's willing. Well, we'll see what happens. I was honored to come here and share. Like I said, I have no problems. I win. I learned this a long time ago, and we will learn as we go on this kind of fun journey. It's interesting. I'm very blessed. I'm the vice president of the Annenberg Foundation, and so I've been able to live a unique life. And it's hard to believe that it's been over a decade of accumulation of material, films, photography, etc., that defines explore.org. And so when someone said, Charlie, do you want to come and speak? Where do you start? Where do you end? So I thought it would be nice to, with anything that you study in life, to kind of go into the origins. One of the ironies of the live cams is, I don't know if there are a lot of photographers in this room or artists and filmmakers, is it put me out of work. Social media, between our Dog Bless You website and these live cams, the beginning of Explore, which was films and photography, has almost taken a back seat. The average time on our website right now is close to 50 minutes. It's a community that really celebrates purity, the selfless actions of humanity in the nonprofit world, and really it's just about lifelong learning. There's no tricks up our sleeve and no advertisements. So I thought we would, if we'd like, because we can improvise, because exploring is always a never-ending journey, but I thought we'd just take kind of a fun sidestep of some of the trips we've done, which have really expanded the globe and are special. I'm not very skilled with the technology, but I said we can figure this out. Daphne, are you okay there? All right. Get comfortable. Little backstory. People always ask me, how did Explore begin? I mean, I've been interviewed a lot, and here we go. Ay, ay, ay. And I think as we grow, I hope to end Back to the Pearls of the Planet on something really special. We can actually share some of the exhibit that's going on here if people want to come back. So we're going to go full circle. But I think what you're really going to see is some of the fabric that holds together this great country and all over the world in selflessness. People often ask me, you know, how did Explore begin? And let's just see if we can cue this.
Hi.
My friend made
this. My name is Charlie, and welcome to Explore. To explore is to dream, to grow, to learn, to experience.
We'll hold. Like I said, I'm going to get used to this, but it's a really funny story. I was, one sec. So we're going to begin in Africa, but I think we need a little backstory, how Explore really began. One day, I happened to come into the Annenberg Foundation. I was working on a similar project, not related to Explore, and Jane Goodall was in the office. And she was talking to my mother, and I think my mom's here, so Mom, wherever you are, hello. And my mom was so captivated by Jane that I remember her saying, we got to go to Africa. We're all going. We're going to do a family trip. This is going to be so wonderful. This is going to be so terrific. And I remember saying to my mom, we're not going to Africa. There's no way, you know, you're going to go into the middle of the bush. And she's like, we're going to go. So I had always wanted to be a traveler, and I'm actually kind of a late bloomer. I really didn't start traveling until my mid-30s, so when I heard this opportunity, I'm like, I'm in. And cut to a few months later, and most of the people who were going to go couldn't make it, and I'm like, I'm still going. And I had this idea. I went to USC Film School, and I was trained to film. I said, well, I'll just take some video cameras, and we'll record it, and I'll bring it home, and we can watch it like we were all there. And little did I know that this kind of random occurrence would really turn into this, like, global adventure of showcasing selfless minds and really championing the human spirit. So I thought we'd start with Africa and just do a little, if we like, a little journey of what we've done and some of the thematics that have grown over time. And so, you know, we'll just begin really quickly. Like I said, there's over 50 to 100,000 images. So when someone said, do this, you know, and that's not even video. So it all began with a trip to Tanzania, where we were building a school on Manyara Ranch with the Africa Wildlife Fund. And then I had heard about this woman in Ethiopia named Mama Babovich. She's a Mother Teresa of Ethiopia. And it would end up in Ghana. So it was kind of a route across there. And the reason why I was intrigued with Explore, you're going to notice as we talk tonight, I have a few taglines. But I really wanted to create a destination of trust, something very pure. And I really wanted to showcase the true heroes of our society, which is the selfless leaders who've almost given up the almighty dollar in pursuit of improving the human condition. I often feel like we live in a society where we talk about drugs and different addictions, but almost the biggest addiction out there is what I call A to D, addicted to drama. And so this was to be a really pure place. And we'll just kind of go through this journey and we'll ad lib. And I think you're going to just see. And so here we are, and this is Manyara Ranch. It was really neat. We were building the school for the Maasai. Special people, obviously some beautiful animals. We were working with the Africa Wildlife Fund. I'm just going to hold there. And it was right around here, and this was, now we had gone to Ethiopia, and we're with Mama Babovich and her kids. These were really unique kids. This woman gave up her life. These are all kids who were born with HIV. And everyone said she was crazy, so she created this orphanage to help raise them. This was in Ghana at the slave dungeons where they would take people away. Dancing has always been a theme. This is a funny story. That's Rita Marley. I'm going to end with this shot. I've always been able to kind of embrace people, and the reason why the shot is funny is by the end of this trip, Rita Marley had really taken to me, and I said, hey, can I be your adopted son? So she went to the tribal village leaders in Ghana, and I've now become Charlie Marley, and it's a name I've used ever since. No, it's a true story. Like, anyone who knows me, it's Charlie Marley. And this was me, actually. I have it on video, too, but I only have so much time, so we had to cut this. And what's unique about Africa, and I just want to stop for a moment, because I'm going to start to thread little themes. Remember, we're going over like 10 years of work, and there's been so many other tangents. Was back to that addicted to drama thing, the media always portrays things in a certain way. And Africa is always portrayed as the world's great pity party. You have AIDS, famine, war, disease, and a few cute animals sprinkled on top. And what you don't realize is that there's that amazing minds doing amazing things. And so that's how this kind of explore journey began. It was kind of like things that were dominated by the media in a certain way and trying to showcase it in a different light. So this became the first trip, and if you're on Explore, there are several films and different things. And it was pretty neat. And then from there, with that thematic, we went to China. And China, if you think about it, everyone should be afraid. Human rights violations, doom and gloom. Well, there's actually extraordinary minds doing extraordinary things there. You just don't hear about it. I always laugh about the human rights thing, like we've never done anything here in America. We're a symbol of all good and justice. So here I am. They've often called me. I've taught in a lot of schools, Professor Charlie, and I've cut a few little clips. This is in an Anwu school. It's a really unique thing. This would be considered like the poorest school in China. So, you know, as we grapple with education here, and with the kids. Hold on. These are just little clips from Explore. Under Chairman Mao.
What do you want to be when you grow up? If you have any questions for your professor, Charlie?
You know, a woman from China recently came and saw that clip and said, they actually said, well, who is this strange man sitting at our desk? So I think the editor at the time was trying to be kind. What's unique about that little clip, and the reason I just pulled a few of them, and I think you're going to see quite a journey tonight, is there's another way to look at it when we talk about China and different things. What I found really fascinating is this is the poorest school, and kids are two to a seat, and they're all becoming bilingual. And I think about our own like school systems, inner cities. So when you look at the future and you talk 20, 30 years down the road, and what a lot of people don't understand with the open market in China today is, you know, these kids are under a lot of pressure because they're only children. And the safety net's gone, so if they don't truly produce, it's a whole new paradigm. But I always found that really fascinating from an education standpoint, that, you know, if you went into our worst school systems, you would, you know, this isn't a private school. This is in the rural countryside. This was the Yangtze River. This young man, Wenbo, he's one of their environmental leaders. You would never hear about him really making tremendous change in alternative energy, marine life conservation, incredible. This was an ancient calligraphy master. Can't go wrong. The pandas, this was a really neat experience. And, you know, we'll remember this moment. I've been really blessed to have met a lot of unique minds, and now at this center we have live cameras, so if we went right now we could actually look at these pandas, not in pre-recorded time, but live, and really observe them. And what's unique about these live cameras is, for me, they actually are an antidote to stress. They really help me. But Jane Goodall said this is the future of conservation, because you could study them 24/7 and become one of the world's foremost citizen scientists in all our nature cams. From there, we went to Tibet. And it wasn't about a political thing. It was really just about a journey into controversy. And what was really neat about Tibet for me was really starting to understand ancient things. I'd like to go back to China for one last quote. That first photo of the Great Wall, I thought it was a great line. I asked a professor there, and I said, you know, what do people think about America? And they said, too early to tell. I mean, these cultures are 2,000 years old. We're not even 50 years old, and we think we know everything. I mean, it's not even a dynasty, and it was really interesting. And so we're just going to drop little pearls of wisdom on the way. So now we're in Tibet. I just think the faces say it all. I was at an orphanage. Those are monks debating. All these are films on explore.org if you ever have time. To the orphanage. So now, like I said, we have limited time, so we're going to go to India. And we've gone to China, and in India, I was really intrigued on two levels. One thing I've learned, there are many themes that explore, but no matter where you go in any culture, people all ask ourselves two questions. Where did we come from and where are we going? I mean, even if you're an atheist, it's a belief system. And so I often look at spirituality on our trips. It's like Microsoft Word. It's the operating system of humanity. So I thought by, you know, going to India, ancient cultures, we would find our ways. And it's very interesting, and I don't know if people can relate to this, where you find true wisdom. And some really beautiful photography I've always felt at Explore. Here I was. This is a great story. I was sitting on the riverbank Ganges and trying to learn to meditate. Good luck with me. How many minutes have I done? This man walks up to me, he puts his hand on my shoulder and says, what do you know? And I just looked at him, I said, all I know is I know nothing. He said, come with me. Next thing I know, I'm in on a ceremony on the Ganga. If you want to know the truth, I didn't understand a word he said. So my spiritual quest, I got it, but I didn't, you know, people are all going to India, they have a caste system, it was a little confusing. I want you to look at some of these photos. So it's, why I say this is it's really bizarre where you find spirituality. I happened to visit an organization called the Rescue Foundation. These were girls who were sold into slavery and kidnapped. And now they've been, like, literally rescued from these brothels. And they had me come to interview them. And how does a guy like me interview them? I mean, I'm probably like, what do you have to say? And one thing I've learned when I've interviewed people is just make people feel comfortable, treat them with respect, don't talk about what's expected. And so we were just talking. And I finally told them, you know, I don't know about you guys, but I'm an Indian. I haven't met one spiritual person. Do any of you guys know yoga or anything? And it says, well, that's how we cope with our illness. So I found my three swamis through three girls in India who...
You do yoga?
I'm trying to learn how to do yoga. Can you teach me a pose?
I'd always had the fantasy of meeting a wise sage who could teach me how to incorporate yogic philosophy into my life. And here in the Rescue Foundation, I'd found the Swamis that I'd been looking for.
Like I said, I've just, you know, shortened this because we have a limited amount of time, and these are really some amazing films. But it was really extraordinary, especially as a man trying to convey it. And if you saw these children's faces and how stoked they were, and just by asking for a yoga lesson, they just opened up and were smiling, and it really allowed them to talk about their release. We did a lot of stuff on music, a lot of themes when we traveled: culture, history, music, spirituality, human rights, the role of women, animal welfare. Beautiful, some of the tigers that have been hunted. Now this is what I talk about, wisdom, and this moment lives forever. I have to share this story. My car had just broken down on the highway, and so I hitched a ride from this man who claimed to be illiterate. I think this might be the smartest piece of wisdom I've ever come across. You strike me as a very intelligent man.
I eat my bread and I know how to ride this camel. That's all I know.
What's the key to living a happy life?
The nearest auto mechanic. And I think my point here is that it's really amazing where you find these pearls of wisdom. So here I was, you know, on the river Gangi with this guru, and it's really in the Rescue Foundation with this simple man. From there, of course, we've been to many other places. We did a journey to the Arctic, clearly to study issues like global warming. And another theme really developed here, traveling through countrysides and places with indigenous culture. We always tell the story through Western eyes, like we just discovered the place, and we don't really hear it from the inside out. Now, remember that polar bear, because this moment in this trip was really a turning point. This is where Pearls of the Planet truly began. When I looked in the eyes of that bear, I just saw a modern-day Gandhi, you know, global warming, starving, wisdom, sage, this wisdom. And I was like, imagine if we could just record this live and allow people to observe these wonderful creatures and just fall in love with them. And years later, when the technology permitted, the first live camera would be with the polar bears in the Arctic, and it's a yearly thing. Indigenous. Back to the operating system of humanity. Clearly, I didn't even bring my reading glasses, this is pointless. Not that I need notes. This trip is really remarkable. I call it the trilogy of books. There's so much misunderstanding and fear based on monotheistic religion, Old Testament, New, and Quran. So I studied all three religions with the hope of sharing their similarities. And on this trip, I actually converted to Islam, where I'd go to Mecca. And this was my imam, Jihad Turk. And it was a really fascinating trip. Like I said, I could give whole talks on this stuff. I broke down this trilogy of books really simply. In the Old Testament, God speaks through miracles. Famine, flood, war. In the New Testament, he says, well, did that work? I don't know. So he humanizes himself through the flesh of Jesus, but grants him the power of miracles. And in Islam, which is really interesting, he's actually the most identical of the prophets. It was just a 40-year-old man who was having a midlife crisis, so he liked to spend a month in a cave. That's what they call Ramadan. When the archangel Gabriel came to him and just said, read. How ironic that the opening line in the Quran is read. And, you know, because the whole issue of illiteracy around the world, knowledge. And so on this trip, I really wanted to learn the three religions, and I could go on and on. Here's a photo. Not many Westerners have probably been to Mecca during their pilgrimage. Just a little clip.
While in Saudi Arabia, I had the rare opportunity to make a pilgrimage to the Kaaba in Mecca, the holiest place in Islam, guided by my Islamic spiritual guide, Imam Jihad Turk.
Entering the Kaaba.
Making a pilgrimage to the Kaaba during the Hajj is one of the five pillars of Islam.
The most sacred stone for the Islamic world.
According to the Quran, the Kaaba was built by Abraham and his son Ishmael. It is the oldest place of monotheistic worship in the world. Part of the ritual pilgrimage includes circling the Kaaba seven times, symbolizing the seven times that Muhammad circled the Kaaba long ago in demonstrating the unity of the believers.
Now I'm in Israel with the rabbis talking religion. This was a Alzheimer's clinic where we were all dancing. This is Bethlehem, birthplace of Jesus, what it looks like outside. This young man, Oren, was kind of ahead of his time. He was actually putting in, it was a program called Shooting Back, and he was putting in cameras so you could just record anything that was happening in the occupied territories. Now, this might be one of the great stories of my life. I could do a whole class on it. I had just met with the Prime Minister of Israel this day, and little did he know, that night, I'd be going into Jenin and interviewing what was considered one of the most wanted terrorists. His name is Zachary Zubaydi, and he was part of an organization called the Freedom Theater. The man right there, that is Julian Meir Kamis, an Israeli actor who was really trying to use arts as healing, which would become a dominant theme at Explore.
بإمكانية إنه يوم واحد أنا كإسرائيلي يعني إحنا مسرحية أقعد معك كصديق.
قعدت معي تالي أسبوعين.
He says you don't have to wait for the future. I had Israeli friends sitting with me already now. It's so twisted. You know, Israelis come here and they are very surprised how they are not being slaughtered because he's a very dangerous terrorist. Please don't kill us.
Yeah. Not yet.
My mother already will kill me when she sees this footage. But one way or another, I'm gone, so toast to new friends, because I'm a goner, no matter how you slice it now.
The gentleman, Meir Kamis, was to be assassinated the following year. I could do a whole class on this guy, Zachary Zubaydi, and what happened that day. It was a true miracle, but we got to move on. One of the, here I am now in Rome as a Catholic. This is Father Valentine. He probably should have been the Pope if it wasn't for politics. Here is the Pope. And there's so much photography. I just had to weed through this. I'd like to end on this Middle East trip. Like, there's some really amazing films on Explore, but one of the great riddles I always say is, so rabbis, imams, priests would come and say, so Charlie, like, who are you? And by the way, how I'm known as Charlie Marley in Africa, in the Islam world, I'm Muhammad Charlie. And I have names everywhere I go. So they'd all say, so Charlie, who are you? And I'd say, I have a riddle for you. If you can answer the riddle, I'll tell you who I am. You can tell a rabbi, are you a studied person? They'd look at you, tell an imam. And I'd say something to the sense of, listen to my heart, feel my wisdom, hear my soul, and tell me who I am, and I'll be that person for you. We all judge so much by the surface. It was really amazing on that trip. If I wore a kippah or a hat, I was a different person. And for the Arab-Israeli conflict, I'm just going to end it pretty simply. I don't want to get too into it. But what you're really dealing with is just a really big dysfunctional family. Is anyone like hate going to Thanksgiving or Christmas dinner? These religions are so intertwined that everyone's just poking at each other because they're so close. But if you really study it, the similarities are just amazing. It was a shocking trip, and there's some really wonderful films on that. The next journey I called Darwanda, and it was to Darfur in Rwanda.
I'm about to be dropped off for 4 nights at the Greater Refugee Camp in South Darfur. We are warned sternly that if we shoot unauthorized photos or video, we will be thrown in jail.
Now, what was really unique about my trip to Darfur was I decided again to use my Islamic background, and because I'd been to Mecca and it's an Islamic culture. And so when I arrived in Darfur, and the fact that I'd been to Mecca and I had a Xerox photo, all the tribal elders just took me in. And I think one of the key points I'm going to make about this what I did what was unique is I realized that these kids and children never, we all go to learn about them, but what I thought I'd do different is bring the world to them and share them what I have done. So I brought like videos and photo albums to kind of share the rest of the world. And I think what's really unique, and this was a lesson I learned because I was with a lot of UN people on this trip, as you'll notice my outfit. So often when we travel and we explore, we refuse to treat other cultures with respect and understanding and dress in their custom. We keep on our clothes and we almost look at things like they're in a zoo. We refuse to immerse and really understand. And by simply the garb, I mean, people at the UN are like, what are you doing? I was like, this is actually really comfortable. There's a reason people are dressing this way. Why are you in your outfit? I love this. And taking a pee is really easy. That was a little scary. Then I went over to Rwanda. This young man, his name is Honore. I think one day he might end up president of the country. He runs the Kigali Memorial Center. His whole family had been slaughtered, and he was really trying to deal with reconciliation and healing. This player. The film we made was called Raindrops Over Rwanda. From there, we did something really unique. If you ever do have the opportunity to go to Rwanda, I was able to visit the gorillas. And I have to really emphasize this, it's become another big theme in my life. Between Darfur and Rwanda, Middle East, I'd really kind of lost a lot of hope in humanity. It was pretty dark. And it was amazing that I would rediscover it through the one thing that's been deemed all violent, the gorilla. Think about its reputation. They're vegetarians. And I'd see myself, and I thought, what a great irony, and again, how we label things. The gorilla might be our most popular film. It's called 98.6% Human. Like I said, little clips from the film. Stay where you are. Stay where you are.
Two black backs showing off, just basically teenagers feeling their oats, all is fine. Gives you an adrenaline rush, though, doesn't it?
Wow. Welcome to explore. Never stop learning. Mountain gorillas, Rwanda.
It's now, on the gorilla thing, I think that's been another big theme of Explore, the power of nature's healing, and that's what I meant by being in the mountains and studying these gorillas, and just nature is such a healing force. Two really neat things happened. We actually, I took Honoree, who, believe it or not, had never even been in his own backyard to see gorillas, because you know what, locals can't afford it. Yet we want them to conserve, and we're worried about poaching, and yet they're jumping into the yards and taking their livestock, and we're saying, hey, hold on, this is our holiday. And so also through that trip, we created a scholarship program in Rwanda that like kind of honored young high school students so they can go trekking and really develop a relationship with their own backyard and nature. It's a pretty special trip. And now we're kind of segueing into 2008, which would be a really big turning point for me, 2008, 2009, with the financial crisis and the home mortgages. And I really realized that how little we know about our own country and our own backyard, and really how special America is. And I really began a journey, and I'm happy to say I've pretty much been to every state and worked with every kind of group in America over the last few years, and it's really my passion. And most people identify us as, you know, international. I always make jokes because, you know, if you help people locally or like in West Virginia or Mississippi, it just doesn't get you very far at a cocktail party. If you've been in Africa or Ethiopia, wow, you say I help people next door. So it was really neat, and I really wanted to understand the fabric of this country, and that's where this next idea, what was really unique is I traveled with my golden retriever, Lucky. He was a service dog. I found him in the pound. This dog ended up all the way to the White House, and it's what created Dog Bless You, which is really my pride and joy. And we're going to take a little trip through America right now. It all kind of started first on a positive after all these hard trips because Lucky had done some search and rescue work. And again, I'm not showing you everything. I started with this trip what I called these two groups of selfless heroes, the modern-day sheriffs of the Wild West, the lifeguards of Hawaii and avalanche search and rescue. It's funny, we were just looking at Waimea Bay because that's where we were. We also did projects, obviously, on nature, the volcanoes. These were a program, Access Surf, that took handicapped children, taught them how to surf. That was Lucky. The lifeguards, that was them trying to find me. And of course, the beautiful humpbacks that come there every year. That was Lucky. And then from there, that was Lucky's double. He'd gotten a little old, had to use it. This was about avalanche search and rescue and the role of the dogs. I had participated in a live avalanche drill I was supposed to be buried for 6 minutes. I ended up being buried for 55. So it was a little scary. The dogs couldn't find me. I thought I was like entering like the Four Seasons underground. I didn't know I was going into a hole, and it was like the real deal, and they covered like 10 feet of snow on me. It was a little intense. That's the dog that found me. I stopped there because it really, with Dog Bless You, we could go so many directions here. Dog Bless You really deals with how animals are the guardian angels of the human spirit. And where the mission of explorers is to champion the selfless acts of others, to me the mission of Dog Bless You is to champion the selfless acts of animals, and in this case, dogs. And so it started with the search and rescue. When there was the tsunami in Japan, we sent 6 dogs there. In fact, pretty much every time, Katrina, hurricanes in Oklahoma, there's probably a Dog Bless You dog on the field. We've also done things with the Seeing Eye dogs, PTSD. One of our dogs just won a Service Dog Year of the Award. It was a Great Dane. All these live cams are on Explore. I'm forcing you guys to watch the old stuff, the antiquities here. So this begins the road trip through America. There's Lucky. This is actually at Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, where we have some really unique guests, Shiloh and Warfield right there. If you want to meet some true sages, there's some really unique people in this audience today. I was actually born in Roswell, New Mexico. They called me a UFO baby, so I had to go there. So I thought we'd start our American journey there. Mom, are you here? I don't know. This is the Moondoogie. That's the house that you lived in, and that's where I was born. That is Roswell, New Mexico, right outside Walker Air Force Base. The house is still intact, and that's me knocking on the door. So that's Wallace Annenberg's home. You know? Pretty neat. American flag still out. I always, when I'm in America on Sunday, love to visit local churches. There's just something about the spiritual fabric. Especially the ones for the misfits, not the, you know, the big grandiose ones. Here we are visiting the elderly. Cowboy. And here we are down on the border at Juarez, Mexico, in El Paso.
That's Lucky.
Lucky.
They like your dog. They say it's really big and cute.
Lucky's at the border, spreading love.
Lucky.
I sent that video to Donald Trump. He said, I'm happy there are no holes in that fence. See? That was a joke. But I couldn't resist. My next project, if I was going to give you a list of really special projects, was in West Virginia a few years ago. There was a mine accident. I call this collection Coal, Cotton, and Cars. They were my next 3 trips, which was West Virginia, Mississippi, and Detroit, really the 3 things that built America. And there had just been a mine explosion. All these miners had died. And I showed up, and there my name became Hillbilly Charlie. This guy was both a preacher and a coal miner, and would give sermons. You see the cross on his helmet under the coal. One of this lady's husband had died in the coal accident. She actually gave me his helmet. It's at my house. This school was probably one of the great moments of my life, Marsh Fork Elementary. We'll hold on to that for a moment. Lucky and I were really an amazing team.
There's nothing more terrifying
than facing a bunch of kids in an elementary school.
Your dad's a coal miner? That's great. What do you guys want to be when you grow up?
Teacher.
Veterinarian.
Coal miner.
Zoologist.
Zoologist.
A doctor.
Doctor.
Artist.
Artist.
Director.
A chef.
Chef? Will you cook for me sometime? Professor Charlie loves to eat. What do you want to be?
A ballerina.
One of the keys of having a great, fun life, it's really simple. And this is what you guys are all learning right now at school. Never stop learning. Never stop learning.
That school was ground zero for the whole environmental movement. It was right under a coal mine. West Virginia was almost like the occupied territories, and they'd fight over this school because of its safety. And through a fluke of just showing up, the Annenberg Foundation was able to build them a whole new school and resolve this issue. So I showed up on a whim at Walmart, and I ended up at the governor's mansion. I bought this jacket that I'm wearing today. That's from there, at JCPenney in West Virginia. Still my favorite jacket. As you see, the preacher put the sign up. Pretty neat. I could go on and on about that experience.
I'm a coal man.
2,000 feet under the ground in a coal mine.
I'm a coal man. I'm a coal man. I'm a coal man.
Amazing people, but that was 2,000 feet under the ground, and I was like, hey, you guys hear that song Soul Man? We got to riff this to Coal Man. We got to hit. So really beautiful people. From there, I went to Mississippi. I changed the name to Blessississippi because I felt so blessed to be there, and we traveled with blues musicians, and we took the Explore Library with us. This guy is super chicken. He's played at the White House. And he was also a cotton picker when he grew up.
I got 11 brothers and sisters, but I come out of a house of 22. Every one of us picked cotton. From grandmother down to grandbaby, we picked cotton. I mean, I was the grandbaby. You get your hands full, you know, and you, boop, you throw it in your sack and you start over again. They'd pull up three or four of them a day, fill it up, leave it in a row, and get another one. Won't be picking his old cotton all day long. Hey, hey, hey. I hear you, bro, Charlie. Hey, hey, hey. They witness with each other. Even a different plantation would be one row, a turn row would be in the middle of us in another plantation, and the other plantation would be doing the same thing, be relating to us in the other field.
And that's basically the birth of the blues.
That's the birth of the blues.
So all these cotton fields and people in here picking and singing and...
That's why it's the home of the blues. Delta cotton fields, home of the blues. This old cotton ain't nothing but white gold. I'm gonna be out here till I'm dead and old. Yeah.
Those were our guides. That's Morgan Freeman and his friend in Mississippi, taking Lucky around in the limo. Fried chicken. You know, because of time, I'm going to speed up. I had another film of us in the schools, but I know people want to probably ask questions and stuff, and so time's an issue. Now I'm in Detroit. Again, art is healing. Looking at the thing that built America. I was a gangster, I was a homeless man, creating vegetable gardens, Sunday church. That's lucky, Detroit Auto Show, Ford wanted to use that. Great moment.
How do you bring people back, Charlie? We kind of send our young people away. Well, I think it's important that we keep them here, but you gotta give them a reason. And I think this right here is a reason.
As Americans, we're obsessed with the import-export economy. You know, trade surplus with China and all these things. And the one thing that Detroit has really excelled in is exporting its youth. And this art project is going to start importing the youth back it's going to become a symbol. And through, I believe, your use of color and imagery, it's just going to spread because it's going to draw people back into the heart of the city and re-nourish and replenish people. And it's going to be its own import economy because people are going to want to start living around here. I think this project will be an import, and that's exciting.
Look at this.
Calling the next
yeah.
Thomas Edison, calling the next Henry Ford, calling the next Rosa Parks. Yeah. We need you.
My job as an artist and educator is how do I elevate the minds of people and take them into heaven? Get the world to elevate their way of thinking to a new level.
So from there, I mean, there's just some really beautiful people in this country. I'm looking at the time. So from there, I did a really unique trip. We did 18 days down the Grand Canyon. And what made it unique is we traveled with Native American Indian tribes who lived on the rim to let them explain it through their soul. Some of the people have passed. It's the night under the stars. This was me making a tent. I don't know if people heard of Winona LaDuke and her group.
Oh, sorry. I'm a little nervous. I've never done this in front of so many ladies in my life.
Yeah.
You know, it's not a...
My grandma can do it better. She's 90.
Grandma can do it better.
Hey. Question.
What is a reservation?
What
are... Reserved.
A very important construct because people think land was given to Indians as land reserved under treaty. In our case, some places it's a little bit worse off, you know, like, but...
So they round up everyone and say this is where you're going to live now?
No, it depends on the community, but a lot of time, like, they spend a lot of time trying to kill the Indians.
Right.
And then they say, well, you know what, maybe we won't kill them, we'll just isolate them. And we leave them there, and then we'll just steal everything else, you know. And so then, because first they start, you know, forcing people like the... They put 97 Indian nations in Oklahoma for the eastern seaboard, you know. And some of those people walk back, you know, walk home. Like in our area, some people like the Ho-Chunks walk home from Oklahoma, walk back. So that's how it's, you know, started. Like that was because they moved from killing to isolation, and then they moved to kind of killing on the reservation.
And lastly, like I said, because of time, this was a project I did in Idaho called Fish Out of Water, and this will be a really pivotal project on many levels, dog bless you, and something really exciting coming up. This is in Idaho. I was working with, again, nature's healing, a fly fishing expedition with the U.S. military, people had been wounded. Remember that guy in the hat? I'll tell you a great story if we have time.
Going to Iraq, and it's 130-something degrees, and you have all your gear on, you're thousands of miles away from home, and, you know, just a day ago, you're talking to a buddy, and today, you know, he got shot in the head, and you saw his head explode. Everyone's like, wow, dude. You joke about it, you laugh, but, you know, you all share that. And when you go into the civilian life, people, you have friends, but you don't have comrades. You feel lonely. Because there's no one else who can understand. There's no one else that you can talk to share your stories. You feel like they've been there.
You know, being with all these other combat vets, I can look at them and I already know that they know we're on the same sheet of music. We're all thinking the same thing.
And there's that survivor's guilt. It's like, I can't believe I made it back. I was the one in charge, but you know, some mother, our fathers and grandmothers had to get the news that, you know, their loved one didn't make it back. And I think about, like, wow, I mean, they deserve to be here more than me. But all these other guys will say the same thing.
So, let's go contemporary and where things lead. That gentleman, his name was Christian Ellis. It was a really unique trip, that trip. They all called me the dude. And it was funny. I was like, I remember all there. No one wanted to be there. Like, I don't want to be here. I don't even like filmmaking this stuff. I'm just here. Forget it. And Christian and I kind of bonded. And I said to him, we were talking by the end. I said, what do you want to do? Like when you were a kid, like what were your dreams? And he said, you're going to laugh, dude, but I wanted to be an opera singer. And a light bulb went off in my head. And I said, I got it. Dude, that was a crazy idea. Let's make an opera on the war in Iraq. Modern day tragedy. Ancient art form. He's like, fuck you, dude. Don't fuck with me. I go, oh, no, I'm serious. I don't know anything about opera, but I know the most famous scene for me is Charlie Don't Surf. Dun, da, dun, da. That's all I knew. Cut to 7 years later. This week, March 12th, at Long Beach Memorial. It'll also be streaming live March 18th on KCET. There's going to be an opera called Fallujah. It is, again, art is healing. It'll be the first opera ever on the war in Iraq. All the art's been done by vets. I was just down at the VA. I mean, I'm almost whipped. I'd like to take out my cell phone and play some of this music. If I know people in LA don't like to leave their geographic zones, but this, it will be live also, like I said, on KCET on March 18th, streamed, but it's really historic. The other thing I say that was unique is, as you saw, this golden retriever and I, we traveled everywhere. We did absolutely everything. You can make a movie about it. It was like Steinbeck. We've been in every state in the country and met everyone. And, you know, there was a story in Idaho on that trip that kind of changed me also. We had to go fly fishing, and someone said, remember I said, look at that photo on that guy? I'll just go back to it quickly. This guy with the hat. Well, I walk in with Lucky, and he's under his bed shaking. Like, he's like, go away, dude. Get the fuck out of here. You know, I'm like, hey, I was just told to get you. He's like, I don't want to go. Just leave me alone. He's like, really upset. And of course, Lucky, like he would, he just walked there. He went under the bed. He put his paw in his hand. I go, hey, dude has a crazy idea. The dog doesn't want to go either. Will you just watch him? I'm leaving because the bus is going. I leave. Cut to 5 minutes later. This guy's walking out, getting in the car, smiling. I had driven everywhere in this country with this dog. And I noticed something. Everyone wants to feel patriotic. We love our animals. We'd like to rescue them. I'd been starting this little website, Dog Bless You.
Go.
And that gave birth to Dog Bless You. It's now over 1 million members strong. And it's the leading provider of service dogs and soldiers in America, in addition to the other search and rescue and working with children. And I don't think there's a purer sight on the web. It is just pure love to its most beautiful. I could do a whole class on it. If you just go and look at the reactions every day on this, it's beyond powerful. And so that trip, you know, to the military, the opera, Dog Bless You. Now we go to Pearls of the Planet, which was a live cams. And, you know, I've never done this before. I don't know the time. I don't know if we should do questions and answers. I had this idea of lowering the lights. What I've been trying to do lately is take things off the internet because it's still lonely and live. And so I've been building these things called natural cathedrals. That's how I look at the Pearls of the Planet. It's some of the most pristine places. And rather than using religious artifacts, you come into these rooms where it's just the power of nature's healing. And so right here, if you came tomorrow, it's Skylight. We have one on the Pacific Ocean, where we have the live cams and some of the best of highlights. We had one on the Arctic with those polar bears. We have one on the brown bears coming up. I mean, there's over 54, 55 cameras. It's truly spectacular. But the question is time. Would we rather do Q&A? Maybe do people have questions? Comments or dim the lights, look at the Pacific, and just go into an immersive world? How do people feel? All of it. Is this even interesting? I don't even know. I'm looking at it. Can you dig it? You know, before we get too deep into questions, you know, really, again, the mission of Explore was to champion the selfless acts of others, to create a portal into the soul of humanity, and to inspire lifelong learning, and to keep the experience pure and not be tainted. And I think if you go to the website or watch us on KCT or Link TV or in festivals, you'll notice that. And it's in through it, Explore is a transitory word. You have the dog bless you, the pearls of the planet. I mean, I could go on many other stories. This opera, which I really encourage. And it'll only be an hour and 30 minutes. I'm not going into the 3-hour snooze fest. It's really neat. I'd like to even play some music. You know, do we want to do questions, or do we want to go like 3 minutes into a live camera?
Do you want to do Q&A? Do you guys want to do some Q&A? So, all right. So this brings us to the Q&A portion of our evening. Before we get started with Q&A, there will be a few guidelines on how we run our Q&A here. There will be two staff members with microphones, myself and Alexis to my left. If you have a question, raise your hand. If your question is selected, please make your way to the nearest aisle so we do not have to reach across your neighbors. Remember, we are recording this, so we ask that you speak clearly into the microphone. In order to help you do this, I will hold the microphone for you. All right, so let's get started. Any questions?
All right, your first question is going to be on your left over here.
Why did Annenberg try to go into the Bologna wetlands and build a structure when people fought for years until the developer bought out the city council? I mean, it's with. Are we going to be like sardines and like the in an old concrete jungle? We have to, you know, people have to have nature. That was sort of, I guess, against your so-called philosophy. You guys tried to build on the Bologna wetlands over there, and you backed down because you saw that people didn't want it.
You know. I'm not involved with that project, but what I can tell you, and I assure you, when it comes to the foundation as a whole, is the intentions are always pure and to be stewards of the public. And you know, I really admire some of the other members of the foundation who have the patience and wherewithal to deal with the bureaucracy of city. And there's always, to every situation, a pro and a con. But at the end of the day, what I can assure you is that the intentions are always for moving things forward. And I can't give you the details of it because it wasn't a project that I was personally involved with. But what I have learned is that there are always two sides to every coin. And some people always like something and some don't. And I can't give you a more detailed thing. But what I can say is thank you for sharing anything you feel. It's always welcome at Explore and at the Foundation.
Did you have a question, sir?
Not a question, actually a comment. I've been watching your live cam on the hummingbirds in Laverne. I'm obsessed. I'm transfixed all day long. I wake up every morning when the sun rises just to see these guys, and it's amazing. It's.
Maybe we could cut over to the hummingbirds right now. They might be live. Oh, it's too dark? Okay.
They're right over here in Laverne, which is near
Pomona. No, you're right, the pandas.
But I'm telling you, 6 a.m., I'm up, and it's on my iPad. It's plugged in. It's all day long. I'm watching these guys. It's amazing.
I'm the same way. I get it.
To me, forget the polar bears, forget the orcas. These hummingbirds are just...
Have you seen the new bald eagle camera?
Yes, I'm looking at all the live.
And have you seen this? This is a gyrate falcon that landed in the Arctic.
No, I haven't seen this, but
this was a rare falcon that just landed on one of our cameras about a week ago, and it was all over the internet.
I was watching the surfers today in Hawaii.
Yeah. Well, you know, welcome to the Explore family, and just know that the whole concept. Is, like I said, we live in a society that's very addicted to drama, and I often think of the pearls of the planet as the antidote to stress, and it's a place to come to absorb the purity, fall in love with the world again, and hearing that is the most meaningful. My currency is your feedback, so thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Next question here, center.
Great talk.
I wanted to ask you something, though, that's a little bit less about your art and your faith, Islam, your connection with Islam. Not anything personal, but have you done anything to kind of foster the understanding, greater understanding among people? There's a lot of fear and misperceptions in this country, and in someone in your position who experienced it might be able to educate us and, like you say, allow us to learn more.
Excellent question. When I began Explore, so there's phases. So it starts with kind of, you know, keep in mind when I started, YouTube didn't exist. I was carrying around cameras this big. So, you know, we've been adapting. And I think my personal dream was to create a destination of trust and a voice. That gentleman who was with me, Jihad Turk, he runs the Imam Center right here in Los Angeles. And he's the most articulate man I've ever met. And he looks like he could be on a J. Crew catalog. And one of the things you're going to observe about, unfortunately, media today is that fear is the ultimate business. It sells everything. And so even when you're dealing with issues of compassion or understanding, they always put shady characters on TV, ones that you might not trust. It's bizarre. And I thought that through these works, we would have to be, I have no tricks up my sleeve, more of a valid voice, and I've encouraged it. With KCT, who's been a partner through Ling TV, I've actually told him, and we probably will do it, to put Jihad and I on the show and at least have a talk, because it's so fascinating when you peel the layers of everything. And so if I was given that opportunity, I would love to discuss it. Some reason, I just need to grow my beard bigger, I guess, and look a little creepier. You know, I don't sell ads, you know, unfortunately, so I don't make it. You know, but I agree with you, and it would have been nice. And that was the intention, was to really break down the misunderstanding and create understanding and replace fear with trust. Those were always key tentpoles of my work. Because if you don't replace fear with trust, humanity is like a dog chasing its tail in circles forever. It's just not going to stop the merry-go-round. And so how do you do that? And it's still an enigma for me. I have to be frank. I thought that more of from the films would come from it.
Next question will be the last question of the evening.
Your last question is actually going to be all the way in the back on your left.
What's your favorite live cam?
I mean, Bird. You know, they're all kids, but I'm sorry. The brown bears of Alaska rule the roost. They are the best. And let me tell you why. Alaska is one of the true great natural cathedrals of this planet. You got light 24/7. You got water coming at you, kinetic energy. You got to see this film we just created, of those pearls of the planet we haven't released. You got brown bears, but they're not starving. They're celebrating life. You have salmon jumping out of the water. There are bears mating. There are bald eagles flying in the air. The northern lights are coming out. Moose might walk by. Foxes, wolves come out. And from a filmmaker's perspective, you have depth of field. And I just love those bears. I have to share something with you for good luck, by the way. It's very rare. I put my JCPenney jacket. I'm not going to do a strip show, but I always wear my dog bless you gear no matter what. I just want you to know. You know, that's what gives me my strength. That's my personal still heart dearest is just those lovely dogs. But I love them all, but something about those bears and its light, and it goes on all year. Anything else, or should we look at a little Pacific Ocean, or do we hit the road? Oh, this is kind of funny. I just want to share this with you. So we're in a photography space. On the live cam thing, there's a feature. It's a little photo icon, and we have a huge fan base. Our fans have taken over 1,700,000 snapshots this year. That's our library, all from the live cams. You know? I mean, it's just remarkable. It's astonishing. The love, the purity of spirit in celebration. It's
What do you think, Charlie? Should we go to the live cams or the Pearls of the Planet video?
This Pearls of the Planet is of the light cams. It's pretty stunning, but I'm up for anything. I'm up for Oh my God. Let's do, how about this, 2 minutes of this live cam experience, because you got to see these visuals. And then, if we can just keep this on, I don't know, you got to leave, you stay, we can do whatever we want. But welcome to Explore, never stop learning. That's our tagline. And you are all part of an extended family of people I know who all are here because you want to improve the human condition. And might not be the most popular place on the web, but we're a pretty unique place, and it's just an honor to meet people live versus the internet. So thank you all for having me here and listening. If you want to escape stress, check it out. nimbly to use nature as healing and come into these rooms, or you can watch it live and escape. Antidote to stress. I always wanted to do a campaign with the president. Like, you know, he looks a little ragged these days, and say, hey, president, how do you escape stress? He looks, it's as simple. I watch the live cams at explore.org. It would help, as you know, but we might not get anything done. This was in Hawaii that you saw. Really unique stuff. I mean, we could go on and on. I mean, this will definitely help you sleep. And I'll hold the dog. Bless you. But thank you again. I don't know if there's any more questions. Real treat to have everyone here. And, you know, thank you again. You're welcome.